we've been, while we're waiting for the video to do something? More than that?
We've seen in previous videos that organisms can reproduce in two different.
Okay, so what we've worked on so far is natural selection, and then we went from natural selection into sexual and asexual reproduction, right? So this video is going to give us a little bit more information about the two, and then we're going to talk about mitosis, and the video over mitosis is kind of a review of some stuff we learned from last year, so there won't be a whole lot of note taking. And then tomorrow we'll do the other, the mitosis, yes.
And we watched this one yesterday.
You watched this one yesterday?
Yeah, I think.
We should have watched, we should have done notes yesterday on, hang on DNA and genetics, and then asexual or sexual versus asexual, right?
Yeah.
So today we're doing pros and cons.
Oh, I thought the one we were just on was.
Well, it's the same person, so I can see, and it starts out kind of the same, so yeah. And you know, Miss Tina messes up pretty frequently, so you know.
We've seen in previous videos.
Doesn't hurt to ask.
Organisms can reproduce in two different ways, either through sexual reproduction, which involves the fusion of two gametes, like a sperm and an egg, and so leads to genetically different offspring, or asexual reproduction, which uses mitosis to form an identical clone of the parent organism. In this video, though, we're going to focus on the advantages and disadvantages of each of these types. Let's start with asexual reproduction. The two main benefits are that only one parent is needed, and the process is very quick.
Alright, so the main benefits of asexual reproduction. Now remember, with asexual reproduction, they don't need a partner, right? And so that would be only one parent is needed, and also the process happens very quickly. And then when they say very quickly, it could be a matter of a couple of days, okay?
This allows a single organism to quickly colonize an entire new area. For example, if you had a piece of food and a single bacteria or fungi landed on it, it could reproduce into two, then four, then eight, and so on, until it forms a whole colony. And if the conditions are right, this can happen within just a couple of days. The same process can happen with some plants. For example, if a single seed gets blown into a new habitat, then once it's grown, it might be able to reproduce asexually to produce loads of clones that colonize the whole area. Now, the downside of asexual reproduction is that because all the offspring are clones, there isn't any genetic variation.
So one of the downsides is there isn't any genetic variations. Why do we need genetic variations? What benefit does genetic variations bring to us?
If a disease can kill you, it'll kill all of you.
So, but if we have genetic variations where we're not all exactly the same as in a clone, then some of us might have immunities to the disease, right? So let's talk about the disease, some of the diseases that we have going around right now that is eliminating part of our population.
Like old people.
Huh?
Like old people.
Okay. So what is out there that's doing that right now?
Corona,
and then also the flu does that every year too. Some people pass away due to the flu or complications of the flu, right? So, but not all of us got it and passed away from it, right? So this has to do with genetic engineering or genetic variants. So some people have more immunities to things than other people do. So if you don't mind, who in here knows they have had it and they have a test, knows they've definitely had it because they have tested positive for it? If you have, raise your hand. Definitely had it positive for it. Okay, thank you. So that's three out of, not very many people have any here today, but you see what I'm saying? How many of you think you've had it, but don't have a test saying, yes, you definitely have it, or haven't had a blood test saying you have the immunities to it? So now we have, you can't have both. Didn't you say you had been tested for it? Oh, sorry, my bad. All right, so he thinks he's had it in his mind, but he doesn't have hardcore proof that he's had it, right? How many in here of you know that you have not had it? You're definitely 100% positive you have not had it. Okay, I have not had it either that I know of. But you have to remember that you could have had it and not have any of the symptoms, so therefore you did not go get tested for it. See what I'm saying? And if you're like, well, Miss Tina, how could you have it and not have any of the symptoms? Well, you could be what they call asymptomatic, which basically you're just a carrier, but it doesn't affect you in an adverse way. Does that make sense? Have you ever heard that term used? I've never had it that I know of. I was tested for it one time, which I went in there knowing I had just a major sinus infection, and that's what I had. But due to it all going around and everything, they tested me for the flu and for it. But I haven't had blood work done to see if I have the antibodies. So I don't know. I mean, if I've had it, then I am I'm just a carrier of it. I didn't have any symptoms. So I'm asymptomatic is what they call it. So you guys could have had it and been asymptomatic. I haven't taken the shot either to keep from having it or to make it where it's not as bad. So that's one example. Another example is the flu. How many of you in here know somebody that gets the flu every year, and maybe they get it more than once a year during flu season, and has taken the flu shot? Some people are just more prone to get it. They don't have the antibodies. And there is people out there who get the flu every year. They might get it once, two or three times a year, some of them, and they've taken the shot and they still get it. And then you have the people out there who never take the shot, and sometimes they get it and sometimes they don't. And then you have the ones who take the shot that don't ever get it. I don't do the flu shot either. And I don't know if it's because I have good immunities or if I'm just lucky, because I know I've worked in a school system for 19 years, so you know I've been exposed to it, right? So my theory is, because I only get it maybe once every 3 or 4 years, so my theory is I have better immunities to that kind of stuff. Now, I'm knock on wood, because, you know, I might get the flu this year. Who knows? That's the way things kind of go. But that's the reason you need that genetic variation. If we didn't have genetic variations, the coronavirus would have wiped us all out, right? Yes? Or a good chance of it, in theory? Or would have wiped more of us out?
This means that if they knew the
disease, so that's why that's a disadvantage,
and one of the offspring is susceptible to it, then chances are that all of them will be susceptible.
Because they're all identical, right?
Out the whole population. It also means that the organisms will have less chance of adapting to new conditions.
And the other downside is they have less chance of adapting. Why do they have less chance of adapting?
Genetic diversity.
Yeah, because they're all exactly alike. So they can't breed to be that ultimate.
Can't adapt and grow dead.
Yeah. They can't They can't breed in the good and breed out the bad, because they're all exactly alike.
Like changes in the climate.
So their dominant genes will always be dominant, and their recessive genes will always be recessive, no matter how many generations it is. Does that make sense, guys? Any questions on that?
Introduction of a new competitor. In contrast, the main benefit of sexual reproduction is that it leads to loads of genetic variation within the population. In the short term, this means that the population is less likely to get wiped out by a single event.
Alright, so the main benefit to sexual reproduction is that there is a lot of genetic variations. So that means that our population, asexual populations or sexual populations, would be less likely to be wiped completely out by one event or disease or virus or whatever.
Like a new disease, because some individuals will be resistant to their virus. In the longer term, it means that the population can adapt to changing conditions, because it allows for evolution to take place. And remember, evolution is just the process by which species change over time.
In the long term, that means due to the genetic variations, that our population, parts of our population, can start adapting and changing to meet the conditions we're in, which is basically evolution. And basically evolution is just species changing over time.
Because the most favorable traits are most likely to be passed on each generation.
And what are the most favorable traits likely to be passed on?
Good stuff.
Because when you're looking for a mate, or when, you know, like when you're a farmer and you own cattle and you go buy a bull, you're going to buy a bull that has certain traits that you want in your herd, right? Which means if that bull has those traits, more than likely they're a dominant trait for them, right? And then that becomes a dominant trait within your herd, so then your herd becomes better. Does that make sense? Okay. So a lot of times your favorable traits, and what I might consider favorable might not be what you consider favorable, right? But I'm going to look for what I think, what I want, so that that the gene will be dominant throughout the years or throughout my herd. Any questions on that?
The main disadvantage of sexual reproduction, though, is that it takes a lot more time and energy than asexual reproduction does. For example, animals have to first of all find their potential mate, which can be time-consuming, and then they also need to impress their mate. This is the reason why some birds have such colorful feathers. It's just because they're useful for impressing their mates, even though they don't help the bird survive at all. Anyway, that's everything for this video.
The other thing on taking longer with sexual, which different animals reproduce at different rates, is on the bacteria or the asexual, they said within a couple of days they could reproduce, right? Well, in humans it takes what, approximately 9 months? Cows and horses are like a year. Elephants, I think it takes them 3 years. Rabbits is what, 3 months? Something like that. I know rabbits are fast. Rabbits and mice and stuff are faster than like cats and dogs, but then cats and dogs can reproduce faster than humans can. But I don't know of any animal that can reproduce in a couple of days. Not to say there's not some out there. There might be. I just don't know of any. So it usually takes us longer after we find that mate to, from the time of fertilization to birth, than it does for asexual. Yes?
Both of the horses and cows are the same. They're going to reproduce at the same time. It depends when you breed them, though. But they'll do it at the same time, right?
Yeah. Okay, so that takes care of yesterday's lesson. So today we're going to start on today's. Now we're going to start on today's lessons. And like I said, most of this is a recap from what we did last year. I think there's only actually one thing that we write down out of this. Okay. But I want you to listen and pay attention because I feel like it was not going to hurt for us to recap.
And check this out. Cool, huh? I bet you wish you could do this. Have a clown, clean up around the apartment for you, go to class, maybe take your mom out to dinner on her birthday. Well, you can't do that. And actually, there are some really good reasons
why you can't
do that. We're going to talk about those in the next episode. But, you know, we can call themselves yourselves. Like almost every single one of them. In fact, they're doing it right now. For any creature bigger than a single-celled organism, all of life stems from cells' ability to reproduce themselves. Because if that's what allows organisms to develop and grow and heal and keep from dying for as long as possible. This particular kind of cell division is called mitosis, and it's responsible for a whole lot of your body's key functions. If you get a cut, your body needs to make new cells.
Okay, so we need to know that mitosis is responsible for
replace those cells. Mitosis, tumor growing in your spine? Unfortunately, again, mitosis.
Okay, mitosis is responsible for the development, growth, healing, and keep from dying as long as possible. If our cells, so mitosis is basically the cells reproducing, right? And we know from last year that that happens and it has a certain path that it goes through and all that, right? And if our cells didn't go through that, what would happen to us?
Dead.
We'd be dead.
Long dead.
You know, because a cell only lives for so long. And then it reproduces and goes on from that. And we learned that last year. But you need to know that mitosis is what helps us to develop, grow, heal, and keep from dying for as long as possible.
This particular kind of cell division is called mitosis. And it's responsible for a whole lot of your body's key functions. If you get a cut, your body needs to make new cells, mitosis. Have too much to drink, damage your liver, you gotta replace those cells. Mitosis, tumor growing.
All right, so that's a good example of how mitosis can keep an individual alive. So when he said, drink too much, damage your liver. Have y'all ever heard of that? Have you ever heard people say he drank himself to death, or she drank herself to death, or she died of a pickled liver? Back when I was a kid, if somebody was an alcoholic, most alcoholics that continue and never stop usually end up dying because the alcohol destroys your liver. Overabundance of alcohol will destroy your liver. And back in my day, they called it a pickled liver. But if you don't have a liver, you can't live, okay? But the liver can repair itself from damage. It has, not all of our organs have the ability to do that. Like our heart, if it gets damaged, other than going through surgery, they might can fix it a little bit. It can't repair itself, right? Same way with your lungs, your kidneys, but your liver can. Your liver can repair itself, which is why it's one of the easier things to be transferred in kidneys, because you have two kidneys, so somebody, and you can live with just one. We've found through science that out, so you could get one of somebody else's kidneys. If we needed a heart from someone, what would have to happen for us to get that heart?
You have to go dead.
Huh? You have to be dead.
Right, somebody else would have to die for us to get a new heart, right? For us to get new lungs, somebody else would have to die, right? But for us to get a new liver, it doesn't always have to be that someone dies, okay? They can take a piece of a person who matches you, you know, your genetics and your blood type and all that, and cut a piece of their liver off and put it inside you, and the piece that was cut off will basically heal itself and continue to work on them, and the piece that they put in you will rejuvenate and start to function. Yes.
Is it going to light up the body? Is it only organs that bed in the body?
Do what?
I think that's why that's the one of the only organs that does that in the body.
Why is the liver the only organ in the body
because
that repairs itself?
Because humanity's probably been drinking itself in years, thinking for thousands of years. Like, probably just the ones that survived were the ones that had to fix themselves repairing the livers.
So you think that that it's a genetic variation?
Yeah.
That our livers have evolved over the years because people drink all the time?
Yeah.
Okay, that's a good theory. Yes.
Yeah.
That's a good theory, right? I mean, that makes sense. The liver is the only one that I know that we can do that with. But it will do that. But if it wasn't for mitosis, it wouldn't be able to do that, right? Because those cells have to split and divide, repair, heal. So that process can also heal you on the inside, certain things on the inside, like it heals certain things on the outside, like a cut and stuff. Okay? Now your skin can do that also. Your skin, I guess, can heal itself and mend itself. So I guess that would be because your skin is considered another organ. All right.
In your spine, unfortunately, again, mitosis. While you go from a 7-pound baby to a 70-pound child, it's not your cells that are increasing in mass. You're just getting more of them over and over and over again. That's mitosis. This process is so central to your life that it will take place in your body over your lifetime about 10 quadrillion times. That's 10,000 billion times. Like all split-ups, it's not easy. It's gonna maybe be a little bit messy. There's a lot of drama, and it can take a surprisingly long amount of time, but trust me, after we're done with it, we'll all be better. So you are made of trillions of cells, just like giraffes and redwood trees. And remember that inside each cell, there's a nucleus that stores your DNA, which contains all of the instructions on how to build you. That DNA is organized into chromosomes, and as we've mentioned before, in your body cells or somatic cells, you have 46 chromosomes grouped into 23 pairs. One of each pair is from your mom, and the other one's from your dad. Cells with all 46 chromosomes are called diploid cells because they have two sets each, and that's what we're focusing on today. You also have haploid cells that have half as many chromosomes as 23. And those are your sex cells. They're produced in an equally fantastic process called meiosis, which we'll be talking about in the next episode. But for now, the main thing to remember about mitosis that allows one cell with 46 chromosomes to split into two cells that are genetically identical, each with 46 chromosomes, all in order to keep the party of life going. Now, the nucleus in your cell controls everything that goes on in the cell. It has all the instructions necessary for making the cell survive. So you don't need to duplicate the whole cell. All you need to do is duplicate the DNA, get it wrapped up, and if you have two separate pockets of DNA, that's all you need to have two new cells. Mitosis takes place in a series of discrete stages called prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. And you can just say that over and over again and let it sink into your head. And part of what's really amazing about this whole process is that while we know what these stages are, we don't always know the underlying mechanisms that make all of them happen. And this is part of science. Science isn't like all the stuff we know.
Science isn't all the stuff we know. This is the last note you have to take in this video. So I will be stopping the recording of the classroom, but you people at home will still need to finish this video. Finish watching it.
How we're trying to figure all this.
So science isn't the stuff we already know, it's how we are trying to figure all the stuff out that we don't know. So science isn't all the stuff that we know, it's how we're trying to figure out all the stuff we don't know. That might show up on the test as a fun fact, bonus question. I'm just putting that out there.
Okay.
write that down.
Stuff out. Consider adjusting.
I still want you to pay attention to the video because it is a recap on last year.
And future biologists have to still figure out. And this is one of them. All right, let's get our clone. So most of their lives, cells hang out in this limbo period called interphase,